Hello and welcome to this on-demand event today. My name is John Cheek. I'm here from UniTasterDays. And with these events, we provide guides to studying different subjects at university. And the subject we're going to be looking at today is forensic anthropology. And I'm really delighted to be joined by Dr. Hannah Koon, joining us from the University of Bradford. Hannah is an Associate Professor of Forensic Archaeology and Anthropology, and is going to give us a guide to what it's going to involve if you are considering studying forensic anthropology at university. So, Hannah, people have tuned in to hear from you, not from me, so I'll keep my intro to a minimum. What I always like to do when we have these conversations is just find out a little bit more about you first. So we call this the what you do and why you do it intro. So can you just tell us a little bit more about yourself and what you do, please?
Okay, and thank you for the invite, John. So my passion and my research focuses around bones, primarily human bones, and what we can tell about people from studying their bones. And I look at different levels, so and different scales. So at a gross level, I look at how the shape and the size of bones can tell us about those people. We can build up a biological profile about their age, their sex. Is it human in the first place, or are we looking at animal bone? These are important questions in forensic anthropology. Under a microscope, we can look at abnormalities on the bone surface. So evidence of disease or trauma, for instance. And then I also look at what's going on inside the bone. So I study ancient biomolecules. So these are, as the name implies, things that were once alive and are now dead and been buried in the burial environment, and how we can extract information from these. Part of my job is a director of the stable isotope lab here at Bradford. And in that role, I look at pockets of information that are trapped in bones and teeth to answer questions about people's diet and health, maybe where they came from in the past, their nutrition. So it's really building up this understanding of a person from birth until death, the life history of an individual by just looking at their skeleton.
Some of these conversations I learn absolutely loads, and I already know this is going to be one of those conversations that I'm going to come out of this learning a lot more than when I started. Now, what I usually do, Hannah, is kind of ask you now, what is forensic anthropology? And I know you kind of touched on that in terms of your role and you know the experience already, but in kind of like basic terms, if a student is thinking, you know what, forensic anthropology sounds really interesting, do you mind just telling me a bit more about what it actually is?
Yeah, certainly. And we can break it down into really the two component parts of forensic anthropology. So anthropology is the study of people in all aspects of it. And the forensic part comes within the medico-legal context. So the role of a forensic anthropology will be to aid in cases where a body is largely skeletalized. And here your job is to help with the identification of the body, perhaps the recovery of the body, and looking at manner of death.
So students now know what, you know, basically what forensic anthropology is. Why should they, kind of put you on the spot a little bit, Hannah, but why should they study it?
Well, I mean, I'm biased, but it's a fascinating field of study. We're all humans, and instinctively we're interested in learning more about ourselves and about other humans. If you're going to spend 3 years of your life studying something at university, pick something that will keep you interested for those 3 years. But also you'll pick up different skills along the way. It's not just learning about bones. By its nature, forensic anthropology is really a multidisciplinary subject. We incorporate aspects of biology, analytical chemistry, archaeology, law, forensic science. You'll learn skills like working in a team, how to present evidence in a professional manner. You will build compelling arguments, develop critical thinking. Hopefully, you'll be exposed to cutting-edge imaging technologies along the way through your subject. You'll learn analytical lab skills, that's vital, high-level anatomy, and aspects of crime scene investigation and field recording. This suite of both specific and then transferable skills will give you a great foundation in moving forward, in applying for jobs, and then in whatever career you want to go into in the future.
So interesting. And actually, you touched on right at the start about, you know, supporting students to make really good decisions and finding out about stuff. And And that's exactly what these videos are about. And there'll be a lot of students that are watching this and school groups watching this that perhaps didn't know anything at all about forensic anthropology, which, you know, going back to when I was at school, I'll be one of those students that are just going to learn so much. So thank you for your time. And I'm really looking forward to asking you a few questions and hearing a bit more. So in terms of what I want to do now is get more of an idea of what students should expect. And you've touched on it sounds very practical, very hands-on. So it'd be nice if you could just touch on that aspect and if there is, you know, a lot of practical and hands-on content as part of the course that they would do.
Sure. So yes, as you say, by the nature of the subject, it's a practical subject. You can expect theory coming from lectures and seminars, and that will be followed by and reinforced by practical lab work. At Bradford, we have three strands that run through our curriculum. And whatever course in forensic anthropology you choose is likely to incorporate some of those three strands. So for us, it's the osteology and the skeletal anatomy. There's the forensic archaeology, so that's more about recovery of remains. And then the forensic science aspect, so the analytical methods you used in getting evidence from the body, but also associated remains from that. And we have a kind of a spiral-like curriculum. So you start in the first year with the basics, and then you build complexity and depth, revisiting these subjects within the 3 years. So if I take, for example, the osteology side, so the study of bones, in the first year, you're likely to be getting your basic anatomy. You'll be learning about evolution. So how we went from hominids up to modern humans, so looking at bipedalism, looking at the increase in brain size and how that changed the morphology of the skull. Year two, you'll be looking at likely comparing humans and animals. So you'll get a bit of a grounding in other animal anatomy. You'll then really go into depth with your human anatomy, because that's a vital skill in forensic anthropology. So as well as what's on the skeleton, you'll learn about how the skeleton is shaped by growth and development, how the muscles and ligaments that are where they attach and how they change the structure of the bone. So it's that in-depth anatomy and be able to distinguish between human and animals. And then we move on to year three. And in year three, it's where you're bringing these skills together. You're using the methods in forensic anthropology to build up biological profiles. So you'll likely have your own skeleton that you will do an age assessment, a sex assessment. You'll build up a biological profile. You'll look at changes that might have happened to it in the burial environment. And you'll write an expert statement. You'll write an expert forensic report on that material. So you're building your skill set as you go along, and that happens for all three components.
And also, Hannah, I'm sure you'll become very good at spelling, because there's a lot of words there that they're not
used to spell. A lot of anatomy spellings, yeah.
Right, then move on now to application tips, if I may. So you've got a student that's interested, they've watched this, they found out more about the course, they think it really is for them. In terms of their application, is there anything that you like to see in a student or an application that you could give us any tips on now?
Yes, certainly. So there isn't an A-level or a BTEC that you can do in forensic anthropology. So usually what we're looking for is a wide range of subjects, but usually at least one science. And it can be quite wide ranging in the science. It's those kind of analytical skills and thinking that we're looking for. Also, experience goes a long way. So if you volunteered on a dig or in a museum, just showing a passion for the subject, that's going to go a long way. So even if the A-levels don't go quite as planned, put in that other experience that you've got, and that will be seen very positively by people reviewing your application. In terms of choosing a course, if you're thinking about going into forensics or into archaeology, choose a course that's got some accreditation by a professional body. So whether that's the Chartered Society of Forensic Sciences or the Chartered Institute for Archaeology. And that'll just ensure that you are studying the right things at the right level and getting the right experience that these people might want you to have when you come onto your career afterwards. And the other thing I'd say is as I've banged on about before, that this is a very practical subject. Make sure where you're going has great lab facilities and also a great reference collection. So we're lucky at Bradford, we've got over 4,000 skeletons from different time periods, and our students get to work on them. They use them for in teaching, but also for research purposes. But wherever you go, they're likely to have a research reference collection from skeletal remains, but do your research beforehand. Look at what you're going to get into when you get there and what's going to be available to you.
The big shout out about research, and actually, if you're watching this, research, and that's part of your research, so you're on the way there. Love it. Right then, I'll ask you now a final question, and it's about careers. And you mentioned actually loads of transferable skills, and I didn't for a second now expect that there would be the amount of transferable skills you mentioned, but now you've done so, it makes perfect sense. There is. But do you want to just give us an idea of what, like a graduate from the Forensic Anthropology course, what they might go on to do afterwards?
So lots of our students stay on for further research. They get bitten by the bug, so they stay on for a master's or a PhD. And if you're really serious about becoming a forensic anthropologist, you need to specialise really and do that extra training. But if you're interested in the field in general, there are plenty of options available for you. And if academia is really not for you. So that's working within the museum sector. So in curation of remains or research within museums, working in archaeological units. So becoming a specialist in osteology within an archaeological unit and becoming a digging archaeologist. Or from the forensic point of view, we've had graduates who've gone on to join the police force or use their analytical skills that they've developed to work in forensic labs. But the range of skills that you will get from this type of course means that really your options are very wide open, whether you want to go into a sciencey side thing, a lab side, or work in more of the commercial sector or in cultural heritage.
Hannah, I know I mentioned that the careers was the last question, but hearing your answers, one thing that really intrigues me. Now, there'll be some students that already know a lot about forensic anthropology, and therefore they're watching this to kind of reinforce what they know. But there'll be a lot of students and actually, you know, adults and maybe teachers that don't know much about it. So you're now working in that area. You would have studied that area. I'm just really intrigued what kind of your journey and how you got to this point and how much you knew, you know, if you turn back time at the point of applying to uni, etc.
Yeah, thanks, John. I guess my journey comes back to when I was a student thinking about going to university. And I was really unsure about what I wanted to do. I liked aspects of the sciences and the arts, and I didn't really want to let go of either of those. And that's kind of evident in the mishmash of A-level subjects that I did. I managed to find a course that was in a BSc joint honours in chemistry with archaeology. So that, to an extent, allowed me to carry on those two different strands. But really, it was a fortuitous summer school that I did while at university, which was an introduction to forensic anthropology and bones, that really ignited that passion and has kept me going on for many years in this subject.
Thanks, Hannah. And also a big shout out for summer schools. I am such an advocate of summer schools. They're such a brilliant opportunity for students to experience uni, experience different subjects and things. And I didn't ever
Definitely.
Your journey as well. Hannah, the final thing for me to do is just say a big, big, big thank you. I've learned so much from this conversation. Really appreciate your time. So just to confirm, that was Dr. Hannah Koon joining us from the University of Bradford. Hannah, thank you.
Thank you. Bye.